microphone this time. Okay, so the background of this introduction, it's correct, but what the thing which you might not be aware of, that if you just look for a track of specialization in Polish science, astronautics doesn't exist. Only aerospace, which is focused on airplanes, or maybe some type of instruments which are fly on satellites, which Polish center, Polish space, Paris Academy, which deals with space, is involved. But there is no such title that you become a master of astronautics, which exists in other parts of the world. In Poland, still doesn't. So if you're passionate about space and you want to be part of space industry, you have really wrong country to born in. So my story is about how to overcome this obstacle. So let's, when you think about astronautics and aerospace in terms of space research, everyone thinks about the guy who is in the space station working in very severe conditions, but it's not all about that. It's also about be prepared for an extension of our presence in the universe. For example, going to Mars, which basically, it's me, but it's not Mars. It's still on Earth, but in very in place which is very similar to condition which you can explain. It's Utah Desert in US. I'm gonna give you more pictures about that lovely place in the end of my presentation, but before I reach this point, it took me 7 years. So this is gonna be a kind of story about how to manage to that. So I started with an application for Polish Air Force, which wasn't that much successful for myself. They came to conclusion after plenty of tests that my way of speaking is not clear enough, that I'm supposed to do something else, like repairing planes, which I said, okay, I'm not interested in that. Be a fighting pilot or nothing at all. So I had to figure out something else. So then I decided to go for a Wrocław University of Technology, which allows me to do my master thesis in cooperation with European Space Agency. It took me 8 years to make it happen. So yes, because if you are applying for space agency for internship even, and you are from a country which has no solid background in space research besides CBK, you're screwed. There's no place for you. So you have to work hard in order to show your qualities in other respects. So I did kind of a few internships in IBM, Google, etc. So then I applying for an internship, which takes 6 months in Aztec in Holland. I was good enough to be accepted. Other people were like 5 years younger than me, but still my small dream came true. But then if your small dreams came true, you just keep asking yourself what you can do next. So for myself, it was continuing my work with a GENSO project, which I was doing in Aztec. It was pretty much a software engineering job. I have to create a software which allows cubes communication with CubeSats. Do you know what CubeSats are? Okay, there's a small cube which has 10 centimeters of a diameter, which it's just some kind of a small satellite which can be built by students. And right now, we are in transition from big satellites to small ones, so the experience in CubeSats are very relevant for a present stage of a space sector development. So I was doing the software to communicate with that, and I was a part of a 20 students team. And yeah, it's a kind of a simple approach. You have a ground station, you have a computer, and you have an algorithm which allows you to communicate. So nothing, there's no rocket science in that. Simple IT engineering. And this is, let's say, one of the results of my work. I was able to track a few satellites and send comments to them if I was in disposal. But then I realized that it's okay, I did that, I managed to make it happen. I came back to Poland, I came to the conclusion, okay, and it's dead end. Because there's no one who's waiting for me. I have to create something more, something bigger, in order to continue my journey. So first of all, I just check what kind of summer schools I can attend. I found one in Albach, which in that year was focused on space weather forecast. Do you know what space weather is? You know what's weather on Earth? So it's simply put it, space weather deals with what's happening between Sun and Earth and beyond, of course. But for our perspectives, was the goal of the project was to figure it out how we can predict what's going to happen on Earth in respect of Sun activity. So I have no clues about how Sun works at that point, but I was a part of the engineering team which was supposed to create a solution for the scientific objectives. And we did it in 10 days. And this project results as a nice publication from, and in many ways it was one of my best publications so far. But then, again, still, lack of knowledge, lack of experience, because if you want to apply for some job elsewhere in Poland, everyone expects from you at least a few years of experience. So then again, find a place where you can just get extra experience. And there is a one place where everyone of you can attend. It's International Space University from Strasbourg. It's a place where everyone who's interested in developing itself in space sector can apply for at least a summer program, which takes about 33 days, or go for a full master program, which is also available. But it comes with a price. Summer program costs about, if you get a scholarship, costs about 10,000 euro, maybe a bit less. So it's still, it's an expensive journey, I can tell you that. But I manage. I did some Google Summer of Code, I make some money, get some also of my savings, and go for 9 weeks to Montreal to work on a few other projects. We were dealing with spacecraft garbage removal. You know what it's all about? I see one person who just gives me a sense that it's not. Okay, imagine that we sent many rockets so far. The last 50 years, we sent about 3,000 rockets, maybe even more. And most parts of those rockets stays up there. So in a few years from now, we're going to deal with a problem that we have no window for sending anything to space because there's going to be high probability of collision. So right now, one of the huge challenges is how to clean our orbits from the garbage. And to give you even bigger perspective, if one satellite collides with some other satellite, it can create 3,000 to 5,000 pieces of debris. And this forms a cloud, which works pretty much like a generator of a bigger cloud. So it's like a snowball which you fall from the top of the hill. After a few years of continuing, let's say, increased number of collisions, it's going to be a really big issue. So that's why they addressed this for our space-related summer programs. It's not only us who are dealing with this project. So even right now, the space agencies are working on that. So this is a group of people, like 120 people from all over the world who are working on that. Not only on that, but also about this project. It was like four projects. I was choosing this one because of my engineering background. As I said, there's still lack of experience, lack of knowledge. So I decided to create something in Poland for others like me who don't have so much resources and time to make it happen. There is a program called Rexus Bexus in the European Space Agency, which allows students from all over Europe to build their experiments and send them to space or to stratosphere. So I decided to use Bexus, which stands for Balloon Project, and build my own experiment. And this experiment is pretty much the biggest achievement from my perspective. The goal was to create a solution which allows us to figure out what's happening in the stratosphere with freon. All of you know what freon is. It's a chemical compound which is significantly making our ozone hole bigger, simply put. So from the knowledge which I had at that time, I concluded that there was a lot of research done on the ground to figure out that freon is really a harmful compound, but there was no one who wanted to go up there and check it. People get Nobel Prize for that research, but nobody really checked what's happening out there. So I wanted to just give my small piece of not advice what to do with it, because we know what to do, but how to say do some research which is significant, and also create a project which encourage young students to work with space sector. So we managed to make it in 1 year with significant help of Polish government. They gave us pretty much 100,000 euro to make it happen in 1 year, and we managed. The prototype was launched in October 2015 from Kiruna in Sweden, in balloon like that. If any one of you guys is familiar with Felix Baumgartner, this is type of balloon which he was using. And we were able to reach 28 kilometers altitude. He was on 38, so he beat us. But he had bigger resources than 100,000 euro. But this project isn't like you start work at home and you bring it over and you can fly it. There's a lot of work which needs to be done, and meetings in ESA and other institutions, it's like a mandatory thing. So we did a lot of cooperation with other universities to make this project happen back in Poland. So it's not like me and my group of students, and we did all that. No, we required about 20 other people to make it happen. And this is a few of the institutions who were helping us. This is like a we also were, let's say, spotted by Canal Plus to make a documentary about this project. So if you want more details, you can go for a program called Wynalazcy Przyszłości. There's a third chapter about this project as well. And this is a team which is building this experiment back in Kiruna. This is how it looks like. There's a lot of electronics, a lot of pumps, and this is pretty much a flying chromatographer, flying laboratory, and this is the first prototype. This is how it looks like before start. And this is a happy team which achieved the flight. As you can see, I'm not there, I'm sleeping. Okay, now this is, let's say, first part. The other part is that when you go back with such a, let's say, exhausted program and project, there's a need to sharing the knowledge. Otherwise, it will be lost. So last 2 years of my life, I spent back in Wrocław to, say, help others to follow my steps. And hopefully next year, there are going to be more projects like that. This is, let's say, biological experiment which my students are working at the moment, and they won one of the European competitions lately with this. But for the, say, the cherry on that pie is what comes when it's unexpected. When I was, say, sharing my knowledge with students back home, there was a need for a trip to Utah, which I told you about in the beginning. So some of my friends were working on sending first Polish team to the Mars Research Desert Station. And they were looking for someone for a placement because one of the crew members didn't get visa. I was lucky enough to be in Utah 2 years before that and lucky enough to have a visa. So I was on a very short list to be part of that team. So there was simply one call and they asked me if you want to go. I said, yes, of course. I quit my job, I packed my backpack, and next week I was in Utah desert for 2 weeks of that research. And so right now it's going to be plain, only pictures which going to show you how beautiful the place is, but whoever wants to know more about the expedition, I can show you during the coffee break. So pretty much this is the end, but now enjoy slides. This is a research station. Our team, fully Polish, as I mentioned. View from a highest mountain in the neighborhood, called Olympus. Us walking through the desert, looking for signs of life and water. This is moonrise. We found water. We had to cook. But if you look carefully on this can, it has a ability to, you can use it for 20 years, from the date of manufacturing. It's a dehydrated food. Yeah. Still, we still have some food from Walmart. And testing in the field. Some of our sponsors gave us some equipment to work with and some procedures to check. Yeah, and some shower to use. It's use only 2 glasses of water to give you a shower. And we were looking for signs of life as well. Let's say we were trained in that kind of research. Holiday day. And for the end, we plan to do the similar simulation in Iceland in 2 years from now. We are now looking for sponsors and other necessary equipment to make it happen. So yeah, I did my challenge and I continue working on that. I hope you're gonna do the same with your challenges. Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Jendrey. Yes, one question.
You mentioned a difficulty to do this kind of research in Poland, which surprised me a little bit because for almost, no, it's less than 10 years, but Poland is a member of ESA. And we have problems, yeah, with somehow getting back the contribution to ESA, which is the highest contribution to international organization we pay in Poland. So you cannot get the support from ESA, Polish ESA, on this kind of research?
I can tell you one thing. ESA is not a problem. ESA gave me opportunity to fly this experiment. I mentioned 100 euro as a budget for our local Polish activity, but this program costs 1 million euro. So we are part of a bigger program. So on that flight, there were 4 experiments flying. So for example, if you want to start this balloon, you need a lot of helium, you need a very sophisticated equipment, which costs a lot of money. So part of our contribution, let's say money which came for our project also were taken from this contribution, but I didn't mention about that because I don't know the number for that. But I presume it's about another 100, maybe 200,000 euro.
Because we are interesting in
the yeah, exactly. But
kind of
as I said, it's not the issue. ESA is not the issue. Poland is an issue.
But you know, it's somehow a very strange situation. Yeah.
I can tell only one thing because I don't want to go too much details. Issue are administration, which is not flexible enough, and professor who are not believing in such a project like that.
Because recently I also heard a presentation in Gdańsk, it was at the beginning of September, it was Mr. Konacki, Dr. Konacki made a presentation about the Polish participation in the, let's say, similar project, because this problem of debris in space is really a very, very serious problem, as you mentioned at the beginning. So he was reporting on the project relating robotic telescopes, which could be used in space for surveillance and tracking of
yeah, looking for asteroids which may hit Earth.
But also for space stations, I think. It's
for protecting of ISS, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So somehow he was quite optimistic about
but do you know his portfolio? He's a very successful person. He's an astronomer. He managed to work in NASA. He had a lot of, say, luck and good contacts, which I hadn't. Because, let's say, every one of us knows that if you have a good network, which you work for quite some time, your amount, probability of your success grows. I start with zero contacts, zero experience, nothing. So
maybe you should work together.
yes, or at some point you manage to get the same contacts, so you are maybe not the competitors, but your point of interest are not, let's say, overlapping at the moment. Say, space sector is very wide space. So for him, working with telescopes and, say, space robotics, it's his challenge. My biggest challenge was to convince Polish universities to allow us as students having the opportunity to work with space sector. So that's the biggest challenge.
Okay, so let's thank Jędrzej and all the speakers again.